In 2020, ASUS, and I usually call it ASUS, but you guys are telling me, look, Brian, you've got to get with the times, it's ASUS. And they have sent in two motherboards here, the TUF Gaming Z490 Plus Wi-Fi, which is coming in at $200 USD and includes at this price point 14 phases, but we'll get onto that soon. ASUS like to call it 14 power stages, but it's also coming in with an option to not have the Wi-Fi 6 and Bluetooth 5 on it for $20 cheaper at $180. Then we've got the Maximus 7 Formula, which is pretty much a hybrid between people who want the latest and greatest highest end motherboard and also potentially want to put water cooling on not just their CPU, but also their motherboard's VRM, where they're using what they call a cross chill design, where EK have given the option to insert water cooling if you want to cool that VRM down. And coming in at $500, this thing definitely better perform for the money. And if there's anything wrong with these boards, I'm gonna let you know in today's review. But with that aside, let's go through the VRM details, the most important part of any motherboard. With the TUF Gaming Wi-Fi, where it's a 12 plus 2 stage design here using Vishay SIC639 50 amp solutions on the MOSFETs. And then for the chokes, we've got 45 amp chokes. And then we've got 5K capacitors. And the PWM controller is the ASP1900B. And all that leads us to the testing now with this VRM. And I use a 10900K, and out of the box, this thing was boosting up to 4.9 gigahertz all cores. The temperatures were absolutely fine here, coming in with 36 degrees on the heatsink and 50 degrees on the VRM itself. Though keep in mind, this was in 19 degree ambience, and I am used to testing in 22 degree ambience, so I will delta adjust these for the graph. And then once we started overclocking the 10900K, it did fall 100 megahertz shy of what I'm used to getting with this 10900K, and that's 5.2 gigahertz. This could only take it up to 5.1 gigahertz, no matter how much extra voltage I gave it, it just would not respond and it would crash out. So the VRM is decent, and the temperatures are very good, coming in with 48 degrees on the heatsink and 78 degrees on the VRM, but we will delta adjust them again, just mainly because if you watch a heap of my other Z490 motherboard reviews, then that way you'll get an apples to apples comparison. But for what it's worth, the power consumption was absolutely fine, testing out 195 watts on the 10900K out of the box, which is very high, but that's normal for this 10 core at 4.9 gigahertz all core. When we did take it to 5.1 gigahertz, it did start to ramp up roughly around 250 watts. And that is pretty high again, but if you want to overclock this thing, it will start using a lot more power. Though that being said, out of the box, there is one critiquing point with the TUF Gaming Wi-Fi, and that is out of the box with the BIOS automatic settings, even if you lock in XMP profiles, I found even after a BIOS update that I had to change the auto optimizer ASUS setting down to the unrestricted limits setting, and that then enabled us to get the results that we've got in these graphs here. Because if you leave it on the auto optimized setting, it did drop the CPU down to 125 watts power usage. And with that, unfortunately, it dropped the CPU down to 4.4 gigahertz all core. So I'd like to see ASUS optimize that with another BIOS update and fix that little problem I came into. Of course, it's easy to fix if you've got this board, then you just go into the BIOS and change it to the third setting and you can lock in your XMP profiles and you get really good performance off this motherboard. Though continuing on with the TUF Gaming Wi-Fi and its onboard audio, they're using the Realtek 1200 DAC here. And this has a -3 decibel roll off on 0 to 10 hertz. And then from I found the higher frequencies and onwards, there was a very slight bit of shake there, but the crosstalk was also really good at -89 decibels. The mic input did show that this is best suited at a volume level of 50 plus 30 dB. So the onboard audio is decent. I've definitely seen better, I've seen worse. I mean, the good points are about it that the crosstalk is really good. However, the frequency response curve could use a little bit of work. Having that slight shake in there is not the best option when I have seen cheaper boards come in with better onboard audio here at the studio. Though the mic import, it will do the job if you are a gamer and you want to get a budget set of headphones. Though testing out everything else on this motherboard, the USB 3 speeds were fine. The 1 gigabit per second NIC was also fine too. And the M.2 shield did a really good job of cooling down the M.2 when I was stress testing that in NVMe drive. And going through the TUF Gaming Wi-Fi BIOS, it's got everything there you would want and then some, especially if you're overclocking on air or water. And you've also got your Q fan control where you can individually control the 5 different PWM fan headers on this board to the fan speeds you want. You've also got 2 12 volt RGB headers, one at the top and one at the bottom. And then in the middle of the board, you have an addressable RGB controller, which you can in the BIOS turn the RGB on and off, but you will have to install software if you want to calibrate the RGB with different components on your system. Then moving over now to the ROG Maximus 7 formula. This here has an OLED display, which you can use to read out CPU temperatures and also put your own logo on if you want that. But it's also got RGB on the bottom, which comes in a sort of subtle styling, which I will say is a really cool design, but you would expect this to be a design like this on a 500 USD board. And the surface of this motherboard has highly reflective bits coupled in with semi-gloss bits, coupled in with matte bits, especially on the heatsink. You do get a power and reset button up the top, as well as a BIOS debug code readout, as well as 2 12 volt and also 2 5 volt addressable RGB headers. You've also got 8 PWM fan headers, which you can control just like the TUF Gaming in the BIOS itself. Now, quickly speaking about the BIOS, it is absolutely fine. I didn't come into any problems when I was tuning the 10900K on this board, even leaving it on the auto ASUS Optimize or changing it to the no limits. We got the same results here, and also overclocking the memory to 4400 megahertz on both the TUF Gaming and the Maximus formula presented no problems. However, moving over to the VRM, 16 power stages, and this one definitely has a high quality VRM. The PWM controller here is the ASP1405, and then for those MOSFETs, we've got the Infineon TDA214720 70 amp MOSFETs, and then for the chokes, they're using MicroFine 45 amp all alloy chokes, and then for the caps, we've got 10K Japanese made solid caps. The move over to the temperatures here, we had 49 degrees in software, 52 degrees on the PCB, and 34 degrees on the heatsink, clocking that to 5.2 gigahertz, which presented absolutely no problems, even on the auto settings. And this is one good thing that I've seen with the Maximus formula versus all the other Z490 boards I've tested. I whacked in 5.2 gigahertz, and this board did the rest on everything else. And it did so very well. Scoring 58 degrees in software on the VRM, 62 degrees on the PCB, and 58 degrees on the heatsink. So that heatsink is definitely starting to soak up a lot of that heat. And speaking of the heatsink itself, it weighs 380 grams. And on the TUF side of things, it's got 132 grams on the heatsink that's mainly cooling the power stages that supply voltage to the CPU. But in total, you get 2 different heatsinks on the TUF Gaming, totaling 226 grams. So the VRM on the Maximus 7 formula is doing an extremely good job, though I will critique, and this is the only critique I have for the Maximus 7 formula, and that is the power consumption. Even though it's looking really good in hardware info, from the wall, it is starting to juice a bit more power, both on the 4.9 and the 5.2 gigahertz. And now what this gives me an indication of is everything else on the board is juicing a bit of power. So that OLED screen, we've got all that extra RGB lighting that is starting to add to your power consumption, as opposed to a board with none of these features on board, but a really good VRM that will give you the same effect, but it will use less power at both out of the box settings and overclocked settings. Then moving through the audio on the Maximus 7 formula, ASUS called this the Supreme FX solution, and it did do a supreme job on the numbers, with the roll-off being only 1.7 decibels from 0 to 10 hertz, and then the crosstalk was negative 91 decibels, which is a really good number, right there at the top of the chart. And for that frequency response curve, after that 10 hertz, that was pretty much flat, perfectly flat, the whole way through. And then for the mic import, you'd want to keep this at a level of 80 volume and plus 30 dB max, though keep in mind they're not using any noise suppression on this mic input as opposed to the TUF Gaming solution. So that means if you've got a good mic that doesn't need a whole lot of power from a separate solution, you could use this for professional recordings. They're going through some of the other features here on the board. The M.2 heat shield does a very good job of cooling down your M.2 drive. Though testing out USB 3 speeds and also the NIC speeds, they were absolutely fine. And ASUS include a 10G NIC and a 2.5G NIC, as well as Wi-Fi 6 and Bluetooth 5. Now testing out the Wi-Fi 6 signal, that was, I have seen stronger here in the studio, but it is doing a pretty good job. I mean, this is going through 20 centimeter thick concrete to my router upstairs, and it's still giving out a 3 signal sign, which is doing a good job. But as for M.2 temperatures, they were also really good. And one thing I will point out is I do like how they've got the readout here on this board to tell you what compatibility that M.2 slot will support, whether it's NVMe or SATA itself. Though that being said, the last feature to go through here is the input and output. And the TUF Gaming has only on the back 6 USB ports, and one of those being a Type C. And then you've got your display and HDMI outs, and then your Wi-Fi 6 connections. You get the antenna included in the box. Then you got 5.1 manual out and optical out. So if anything, I would like to see 2 more USB ports. You'll also need to install your own IO shield, as opposed to the Maximus 7 formula here, which has a phenomenal input output design with your BIOS flashback and then your clear CMOS buttons at the top, followed by a healthy 10 USB ports, one of those being a Type C, and then you got your 10 and 2.5G NICs, PS2 support combo if you want to hook up a PS2 mouse or keyboard, you get Wi-Fi 6 connections, 5.1 manual out, and your optical output as well. And the IO shield is integrated into the motherboard. And with all that out of the way, it's now time for a conclusion. And of course, the big question you'll want answered is, are these boards worth the money? And the first one we're gonna start off here with is the TUF Gaming Plus. And this has the Wi-Fi, so if you need the Wi-Fi 6 and the Bluetooth 5, then that extra $20 over the TUF Gaming non-Wi-Fi is a no-brainer in my opinion. But at $180 for just the board without the Wi-Fi, it is giving some really good value in the Z490 realm, especially since it could handle a 10900K both out of the box absolutely fine, but even overclocked, and the VRM temperatures were really good. Of course, they haven't used the best of the best components, and you can't expect them to at this budget, and so that only enables it to take a 10900K to 5.1 gigahertz. Though that being said, everything else checked out on this motherboard, except that BIOS setting, which if you get this board, you will want to change that in my opinion. The onboard audio was decent, the M.2 shield worked fine, memory overclocks were fine on this board. So overall, they've done a really good job of offering a good value board for Z490 mainstream. And lastly, what about the formula, the 500 USD monster? In Australia, it is 999 Aussie, so I would like to see the Aussie pricing come down. But with that said, if you're after the best of the best for a motherboard, you want the best overclocks, you want to add water, and you want that VRM giving you the best results, supplying voltage to that CPU, you want really good onboard audio, 10G NIC, Wi-Fi 6, all the bells and whistles, and even an OLED screen on your motherboard, then this is going to be one to get. It passed all the tests here. There was really nothing wrong with this board, except for the extra power consumption, for the RGB, the OLED screen, the debug light, and also all the extra sensors on board. But I'm sure you're going to want that if you want the best of the best of the best of the best
of the best of the best
motherboard out there for Z490. So overall, these two boards here in today's review, ASUS have done a really good job. I couldn't find anything glaringly wrong with these motherboards. And with that aside, if you guys enjoyed today's double review, then be sure to hit that like button for us and let us know in the comment section below what you think of ASUS in 2020. Love reading your thoughts and opinions, just like this question of the day here, which comes from Marshmallow Wolf, and they ask, you never really explained why 18 amps and 12 volt was a bad thing, but 37 amps and 12 volt is a good thing. What is a good number to look for? What's the relationship between them in terms of power supplies? So basically the relationship between those two is the wattage the power supply can put out, and a good number to look for would be, yeah, around at least 37 amps and higher if you are building a gaming PC with a decent graphics card. But the 18 amps and 12 volt isn't always a bad thing. It's not always a bad thing. It's just most of the time, especially on power supplies from brands you've never heard of before, it is a bad thing because they don't put good components in, and that's why the amp rating is very low. However, that being said, if you've got a Delta in a small business form factor power supply, that can actually be a decent power supply. It's just not rated to go and power a gaming computer with higher wattage requirements. Anyway, hope that answers that question, and I'll catch you guys in another tech video very soon. If you've stayed this far and you're enjoying that content and you want to see it the moment it drops, be sure to hit that sub button and ring that bell on the way out, and I'll catch you in the next one very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.